It's a beautiful evening here for some football in Flowermound, Texas. It is the Hurst LD Bell Blue Raiders versus your Flowermound Jaguars alongside Hayden Bumpus. I'm Shepard Branch. Hayden, Jaguars picked up a huge win last week at Byron Nelson with a victory there. That was their first district victory so far, 1-1 in district. 2-3 on the season. What are the Jaguars going to have to do to move the chain forward in their push to the playoffs?
We've seen it time and time again how great this defense is. And for the first time, I think we're facing a team that is based around their defense. That's their rock. That's their go-to. So I think our key is going to have to be running the ball and pounding the ball up the middle and really just yards.
And the Jaguar offense last week was instrumental in that win. Did not necessarily play too hot in the first half, but they did put up 21 points in the third quarter. They went for 265 yards in that third quarter, only giving up 270 yards to Byron Nelson in the whole game. So the Jaguar offense, usually we have seen them throughout the season get very hot at the beginning of the game, put together some very good drives, and then kind of simmer off from there. But it was a different Jaguar team that we saw, with the headline being that defense playing stout throughout the whole game.
Yeah, the first half really against a not great Byron Nelson team, 0-5. Not great, but a good job of staying in the game, not getting your head down, and coming back in the third quarter and really dropping the hammer, as you say here in Flowermound.
In this LD Bell defense is what is going to cause problems for the Jaguars. It is going to be a heavyweight fight of the Jaguars with their offense that is hot and cold at times, but whenever we see them play well, it's better than any team that we've seen all season, going up against an LD Bell defense that only scored 7 points against Hebron in their loss, ended up losing 21-7, and then only scoring 21 points against Flowermound Marcus. This team does not score a lot of points. The only way that they're going to win this game is if they do stop the Jaguars and get some lucky breaks, but that defense is really what is going to be the catalyst for LD Bell to pick up their first district win and really put a speed bump in the road for this Jaguar team that is trying to make a run to the playoffs. We'll be back with some starting lineups, and it's homecoming here for Flowermound Jaguars, so we will go through our homecoming procedures here on the field, talk about the people of the homecoming court here in a few minutes, and we will be back on Flowermound Sports Network in Friday Night Glory.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, please direct your attention to the 50-yard line as an FAHS student council presents the 2016 Logan Report. The freshman Lauren Lady of Pierce Heckins and Logan Meacher. Pierce is the son of Robert and Lynn Heckins. Logan is the daughter of Tom and Logan Meacher.
Back here at Neil E. Wilson Stadium, we're going to go ahead and go through some of our homecoming kings and queens, princes and knights, whatever medieval term you want to do. Hayden Bumpus is going to go ahead and go through it for us now.
Representing the freshmen, we have freshman Lady Logan Dietrich and freshman Lord Pierce Hudgens. And now for the sophomores, your sophomore Duchess will be McKenna McGraw and sophomore Duke Jake Ferris. Next, we're going to go ahead and go. Our junior prince and princess are walking out. Our junior prince, that is Dean Deerabue.
Deerabue.
That's fun to say. And our junior princess, Grace Ulfers. Excuse me, Deerabue is the last name on that.
And Grace is a rosette, too, so she has a... You could hear it from all the way up here. The whole rosettes were cheering very hard for Miss Grace Ulfers as the junior princess.
And now for our seniors. One of the homecoming queen nominees walking out is Anna Carter. Anna Carter, the boyfriend of Brandon Baku, the star defensive lineman who just won the WFAA Player of the Week. Next, we have Bailey Goodman walking out.
Speaking of Brandon McCoo, we will definitely talk more about him throughout the game. Is what a feat to win the Player of the Week, something that a Jaguar has never done before. So very exciting for the team.
That's right. Next, we have Emily Peliquin, girlfriend of Jack Miller, the star tight end for the Jaguars. Jack, obviously a key part of this Flower Mound offense.
Emily Peliquin, a key part of this homecoming court.
Absolutely. Next we have Taylor Sorna. Taylor Sorna.
She got my vote.
She did have my vote as well. So awesome to see her out there. Next we have Nicole Zhang from the band, and you can hear the band go crazy.
That was a roar. That was unbelievable.
Boyfriend of one of a decent friend of mine, Nicholas Che.
Also a good friend of mine as well, yeah.
That's right.
Nick Che is going on a scholarship to Ecuador. Won a National Geographic scholarship, yeah.
I've been there before. Went there for a mission trip not too long ago. Next, we have the males. And our first senior king nominee is Aditya Iswara. I have no idea who he is.
Aditya,
but
I'm pretty
seems
sure
like a
he's
nice
the
guy.
One kid in our class. Not gonna lie.
He looks smart.
I'm pretty sure he's our number one. So
next we have hopefully the future king. He had my vote, and that is Billy Sikora.
Instrumental part of the Jaguars on the offensive side of the ball. He is a great wide receiver and a good buddy of ours.
Good buddy. Definitely had my vote. Next we have Matthew Spretz rocking the teal, khaki, and gray today.
I tell you what, that is a that's something else. That's a bold play.
Trying to make a statement, I think, and that's your call if it's working or not.
Former golfer
Matthew Webb, an FCA leader and student council president.
I'm talking. You want to talk
grade
about
a
well-rounded
student.
Football player? It's a well-rounded student right there.
That is right. Just a well-rounded person. Grade A, up and down, amazing person. Next we have Brian Zhao, member of something.
We didn't hear that.
He said something. I didn't hear what he said. But the choir. He's a member of the choir. That's awesome.
We love the choir.
And he's going to go ahead and make his way down with the rest of the senior king nominees. And I'll go ahead and go over those one more time. Your senior king nominees are Aditya Iswara, Billy Sikora, Matthew Spretz, Matthew Webb, and Brian Zhao. And your homecoming queen nominees are Anna Carter, Bailey Goodman, Emily Peliquin, Taylor Sorna, and Nicole Zhang.
Now Miss Leo comes out to the 50-yard line. Our wonderful principal, everything she does for the school is just phenomenal. And so Nicole Zhang wins as homecoming queen.
Nicole Zhang, an
tell
upset.
You what, tell you what,
upset
that was
city.
Tell you what, that was a that was something else. That was a 8 versus 9, you know, but the 9 won, but the upset, that was still an upset.
I think the clear favorite going into it was Taylor Sorna.
Taylor Sorna had a lot of people's votes, but, you know, whenever you get the band on your side, that's a lot of people. Tell you what.
You can see Taylor Sorna is shocked right now.
I tell you what, just absolutely stunned.
And next.
And it's Matthew Spretz. That's another.
Huge upset again. This is interesting, but congratulations to the both of them. That is awesome.
That's some of the most exciting stuff we've seen all season. That was unbelievable.
A couple of great people there. I know both of them.
They're great people.
Great people. Well deserving of the homecoming king and queen honor. And we'll go and go over that one more time. Your homecoming queen, Nicole Zhang, and your homecoming king, Matthew Spretz.
That's crazy. We'll be back with football here on Flyermount Sports Network and Friday Night Glory. It is the rosters for both Flyermount Jaguars and LD Bell Blue Raiders right after this.
Lakeside Eye Care, Titus Company, Grand Person Landscape, and Protect Service Company. And now entering the field are your award-winning Flower Mound High School Rosettes. The Rosettes are under the direction of Hannah Elmore. And now please rise as L.D. Bell High School plays the L.D. Bell High School school song. Flower Mound High School would like to thank the following sponsors for supplying the press box with food and drinks for tonight's game. Raising Cane's, TC's Pizza, and Chick-fil-A in Founders Square. Thank you to our sponsors.
Thank you.
Lower Mound has won the toss and elects to defer to the second half. The Blue Raiders will receive the opening kickoff, and Flower Mound will defend the north end zone. Officials for tonight's game, referee Louis Lomax, umpire Kyle Meeks. And now, ladies and gentlemen, before we begin tonight's game, we ask that you join us in honoring America. At the 50-yard line, the national and state colors are presented by the Flower Mound High School Air Force Junior ROTC, led by Group Commander Cadet Andrew Kim and Deputy Commander Cadet Mary Master. Carrying the U.S. flag is Cadet Ashley Keller. Carrying the Texas flag is Cadet Nathan Frank. And escorting the colors are Cadet Mary Master and Cadet Andre Glover. And now we ask that you stand, remove all hats, and honor America as our national anthem is performed by the Flower Mound High School Jaguar Band.
It's football time in Texas alongside Hayden Bumpus. I'm Trevor Branch. Hayden, Jaguars will be kicking off. They won the toss, chose to defer to the second half, so Josh Grant will be the first player to touch the ball tonight. It is the Jaguars in Navy versus the LD Bell Blue Raiders in their North Carolina-esque uniforms with the baby blue helmets, baby blue pants, and white jerseys. Josh Grant will kick it off from the 40 and downwind. He sails this one into the end zone. It will not be returned, and LD Bell will start with the ball.
The Flower Mound Jaguars choosing to defer because they know that they can get a stop here quick. This Flower Mound defense has been stellar all year, led by Connor Lee and WFAA Player of the Week, Brandon Baku.
tell you what, Coach Basil has been very strategic with winning the tosses, setting his team up for success from the very start, and they have not missed an opportunity to get off to a fast start in a game this season, looking to keep that going. Here, the LD Blue Raiders, a predominantly running offense, will stack their backfield, and it is a flag on the first, before the first play of the game. It will be false start on the offense, and that's going to move them back an extra 5 yards. Jaguars already winning the turnover or the penalty margin here tonight.
Last week we saw the Jaguars struggling with penalties. Basil, I'm sure, got onto them about that, and this week trying to win that battle.
LD Bell is going to hand it off to their running back up the seam to the, looks like the 22-yard line. That will be a gain of 2 yards. Going to be second down and 13 for the Blue Raiders. They went with one wide receiver in that formation right there. They had three players other than the quarterback in the backfield. And you can see that they really do like to run the ball. They will have two running backs now on either side of the quarterback. That quarterback being number 8 for LD Bell. And that's Aaron Dozier. He's going to get the snap. He's going to fake the handoff, and he's going to throw it out to his wide receiver. That was to number 26 for LD Bell. Terry Pace, he's a running back that came out from the backfield, and it will now be third down and 13 for LD Bell. Jaguars looking to get a three and out here to start this district game.
Number 8, Aaron Dozier, not the normal starting quarterback. It's usually number 6, Austin Brookham, but not playing today. Don't know why.
And he is running out to his right, and he's looking for somebody. Connor Lee is going to make the tackle. And I tell you what, I'll be completely honest, that might be a 6 on the jersey. These jersey numbers are a little bit difficult to try and figure out. The 6 and the 8 look deathly familiar. And I would really like to think that it is actually Austin Brookham who is out there. He is going to be the punter as well. Not going to be a quick kick here. They will look to go to the regular formation. Brookham's going to get the snap. And he's going to punt this one low away. It is going to scream down towards the Jaguar 50-yard line. It will stop on the LD Bell side. That is about a 25-yard punt there from Brookham, and the Jaguars get a crucial three and out to start this game here at Neil E. Wilson Stadium.
This drive right here is going to be very important for the Jaguar offense to get some momentum and get something going. The defense has done their job. Now it's time for the offense to do their job against this solid LD Bell defense.
Jackson Averett will be the quarterback for the Jaguars. Afaini Uzawehi will be the running back. Averett going to go with the hard count there. Going to look to the sideline. We have Jack Miller in the slot to the near side. Jake Welch is going to be the outside receiver here on the near side. And then two receivers to the far side. Uzawehi in motion. They're going to throw a screen to Welch. Zach Welch on the left side. He is going to break a tackle, get down to the 39-yard line. That is going to be a gain of 9, second down and 1 for the Jaguars.
Zach Welch, a key part of this Jaguar offense. He is the leading receiver right now for the Jaguars, receiving for over 200 yards and a touchdown. And the most important stat for him is 12 yards per catch.
They're going to hand it off to Afaini. Afaini's going to hit a gap. He's running with space. He's going to get tackled by what looked like the horse collar. No flag on the play. He was stopped up by a very big horse collar tackle there. Not going to actually get brought down, but he is going to get all the way to the 25-yard line, and the Jaguars are going to go with their hurry-up offense, trying to catch this LD Bell defense off guard. Averett's going to throw a screen pass to Sakura. He's going to get down to the 20-yard line, gain of 5 for the Jaguars. Now within the red zone here in this first drive, just 2 minutes knocked off the clock so far.
It would be crucial right here for the, excuse me, it would be very good for the offense to score here and not settle for a field goal to really create a gap, a quick gap.
Averett's going to pull it back. He's going to throw it to Welch. Welch almost caught it in the end zone. It was a fingertip or so away from being pulled down. That's all right. I like to see that from the Jaguar offense going with those the big plays there. Looked like they saw a break in the secondary there and tried to exploit it. Good call there from Coach Grantham, the offensive coordinator for the Jaguars.
And a decent pass from Jackson Averett. Welch just couldn't get a hold of it. But great to see that from Averett. Not the best long ball thrower, but a good pass there.
It will be third down and 4:47 left in the first quarter here for the Jaguars. Averett's going to motion a Finey to the left side, to the right side now. He will now motion him to the left, and he's going to hand it off to Uzuwehi, and Uzuwehi is going to get what looks like a first down, depending on the spot. And it's going to be a yard short. Fourth down and one for the Jaguars. I'd love to see them go for it here. I think that they're close enough and that they have a good enough running game and enough power on their front six here to get a first down. They will go for it here. Two wide receivers to the near side, two wide receivers to the far side. It looks like they're pulling Jack Miller out in this slot. Not going to have a block on the line. Averett, motion from Ifeanyi. And they're going to hand it. Nope, Averett's going to keep it, and he's going to get the first down. He will get all the way to the 12.5-yard line. First down, Jaguars.
That play is really the bread and butter of this Flyermount Jaguar offense. We've seen it time and time again from Jackson Averett. He's rushed for 7 touchdowns this year. An amazing stat there. And look to see a lot of that tonight again.
He is really toying with this front seven here for LD Bell. He is looking. He is looking. Going to throw it behind Billy Sikora. Sikora is going to fight his way into the end zone. Touchdown, Jaguars. What a phenomenal play there by the offense to score that touchdown.
You can see the amazing patience from Jackson Averett and the great job up from the line. And Billy Sikora doing a great job of getting open and finding his quarterback for the touchdown.
Zach Welch is going to go out, and he will be the quarterback there for the Jaguars in their attempt for that two-point conversion. LD Bell sniffs it out, and they will send the place kicker, Josh Grant, out to tack on this extra point and extend the Jaguar lead to 7-0. The hold from Sikora and Grant. It's good. Jaguars lead 7-0, 8:31 left in the first quarter. We'll be back on Flyermount Sports Network and Friday Night Glory.
And now your Jaguar Sports Card recap, sponsored by Rapid Fed Chair. The Jaguar 6-play Sports Card number 48 yards is good. 2 minutes and 28 seconds off the clock. Hitting it a Jackson Averett. 13-yard touchdown pass to Billy Sikora. And with 8:31 remaining in the first quarter, your score, Jaguars 7, Raiders 0.
Took a little bit under 3 minutes there for the Jaguars to go all the way down the field from the 49-yard line to score that touchdown. It was a pitch and catch from Jackson Averett to Billy Sikora, 12 yards out, and that will result in the first touchdown for the Jaguars. They now lead 7-0 against Hurst LD Bell. Jaguars, Hayden, they got off to a phenomenal start, really ideal start that Coach Brian Basil could put up and draw out. 8:31 left in this first quarter, and the Jaguars have their first lead as Josh Grant hits this one into the end zone. It will be another touchback, and LD Bell will start their second offensive possession from the 25-yard line.
The Jaguars really blessed with great field position last drive. The poor punt from the LD Bell quarterback, who is their punter. But really, you can't script it any better how you want to start. A good solid drive. Really no mistakes in it.
LD Bell is going to throw 3 running backs out to surround their quarterback, number 6, Austin Brookham. Brookham is going to get the snap, and he is going to hand it off to his Running back in Connor Lee comes flying in from the middle linebacker position to sack the running back for a loss of 5 yards. That was number 25 for LD Bell. LaVon Williams with the carry. He was the running back to the left of the quarterback, Brookham, and that will result in a loss of 6 yards, for LD Bell. Second and 16 now from the 19. Brookham is going to hand it off to the running back. Connor Lee is going to miss on his tackle, but swarm tackling there from the Jaguars. Only a gain of 1 there for LD Bell.
That was number 23, Ivan Traylor, with the carry. The Jaguars doing a great job of keeping this LD Bell offense out of the positive yardage right now. They're in the negative.
And this has got to be just easy for this defense. I tell you what, if you are expecting a run every single time, then you know, you could push your secondary up a little bit more and you kind of know what's coming, and it will not be a run this time. Brookham's looking to go deep. He's got a wide receiver open, blown coverage by the Jaguars, and that is number 2, Ricky Walton, in stride. That is a touchdown for LD Bell. And right as I say it, it is a touchdown thrown by Brookham. He goes the distance to Ricky Walton, and that is a touchdown, LD Bell. 7:16 left in this first quarter.
We've seen the struggles from the secondary here for the Jaguars, and again,
I'll take the L on that one.
The LD Bell Blue Raiders seeing the just opportunity to go for the deep ball because of how close the secondary was playing, prepared for that run.
And it looked like you're playing street football, and you got a cornerback and a safety that are covering one person, and they're trying to figure out which one's supposed to cover which, while in the meantime the wide receiver runs right up the seam and nobody's even around him. It was definitely miscommunication there from the secondary, and a team that has not been known to throw the football. Austin Brookham has only thrown for, 598 yards all season, 2 touchdowns with a 51% completion rate, and he made that secondary look like, well, looked like he was an all-star quarterback there. And tough for the Jaguars to swallow that pill, but it is what it is. Jaguars now are tied with the LD Bell Blue Raiders 7-7, 7:16 left in this first quarter. Alongside Hayden Bumpus, I'm Trevor Branch. This is Friday Night Glory and Flyer Mound Sports Network's coverage of your Flyer Mound Jaguar football.
If you are the Jaguars, you're not worried, though. You're confident in this offense, who just had a great drive. And your defense is still playing well. One play is not going to define your defensive performance. So the Jaguars just need to go out, put more points on the board, and get a stop.
Now, LD Bell here is kicking into about a 20-mile-per-hour sustained wind, and this kicker looks like he's going to pooch it to Jack Miller, and that is not a person you necessarily want to kick to. Jack Miller is going to get about 6 yards from where he caught the ball at the 35-yard line. It will be to the 42, and that is where the Jaguars will start this second possession, trying to eliminate their blown coverage on the defensive side with a quick touchdown here and get that 7-point lead back.
Great field position again for the Jaguars. Last time starting from, I think, about the 50-yard line, maybe a little closer.
About the 49.
About the 49-yard line. That's close. And this time starting from their own 42. So great field position, looking to capitalize on it.
Averett is going to be the quarterback still for the Jaguars. If finding his way, he in the backfield. Two wide receivers to the near side. Max Wadding in motion, they're going to pitch it to him. Finney's going to go out and block. Wadding is going to get only about a yard off of the run. But the Jaguars, it's almost like that first play is just, you know, trying to spark the offense, get the pace up a little bit, get that no-huddle offense moving so that this LD Bell defense can be caught off guard like they were so many times on that last offensive possession for the Jaguars.
The Jaguars not going to roll with the quick offense here. They're going to go ahead and do a double check and look back at the OC, Coach Grantham.
Averett's going to throw a screen pass to Billy Sikora. He is going to lower his head and get 7 yards on the play, all the way to the 49-yard line for the Jaguars. It is going to be Third down and one for the Jaguars here with 6:46 left in the first quarter. Jaguars tied with the LD Bell Blue Raiders 7-7.
Expecting either a screen pass or a draw play. Their bread and butter, obviously, the draw play.
Averett looking to the sideline, getting the play from OC Coach Grantham. He is going to switch it at the line. Nice little audible there, showing a lot of poise. Very young quarterback coming into his own. Afaini is going to be in motion, and they're going to hand it off to him. He's going to make one move, and he is going to get pushed all the way to the first down marker. That will be a first down for the Jaguars. They will get a fresh set of downs here. And that's going to be a gain of two for Uzawehi. Afaini is going to be a huge key for the Jaguars because his running is what balances out the passing game for the Jaguars. So, you know, if he can get that defense thinking about what he's going to be doing all the time, then this pass game is going to be on point. It will be a slant pass to Zach Welch. He's going to break a tackle, get tripped up by the LD Bell defender. That was number one for LD Bell. Devontae Dawson, the senior defensive back with the tackle. Jaguars get the first down. They're going to go quick, throw a screen to Welch again. He will not get the same yardage on that play. Number 48 for LD Bell. Nate Alexander, junior linebacker, making the tackle there.
Brian Basil has done a great job of making really the most balanced team in probably 4 or 5 years for the Jaguars. A solid offense that can put up yards and really maybe the best defense we've ever had.
That is not an exaggeration by any means. This defense is playing very, very well, very unlike what Flymound is used to seeing. A screen pass to Wadding, and he almost broke the tackle, but that was number 15 for LD Bell. Derek Thomas with the stop. One more broken tackle there from Max Wadding, and he would have had a chance to score on that play, but it was an all-for-naught situation there, as it will now be third down and five for the Jaguars.
You're confident in your kicker right now. If you don't get this first down, I say you take the points.
Especially downwind.
Downwind, it's fairly long, but your kicker, obviously one of the best in the nation, hasn't shown it so far this year, but has a lot to prove, and he knows that.
Wadding in motion, they're going to pitch it to him again, and Afaini completely missed his blocking right there. Let a defensive back missed him right there, and then that was the player that came in and tackled Max Wadding. That was number 55 for LD Bell, Michael Dyson. And it looks like the Jaguars are in that awkward yardage where it's a really long field goal, but you really don't want to punt it. So I think that Coach Basil is going to have them go for it here.
I definitely think you want to look to pass here. LD Bell has sort of figured out the run game on this drive a little bit, but the Jaguars are going to go ahead and take a timeout.
We'll take that timeout with them. Jaguars tied up with the LD Bell Blue Raiders, 7-7, 3:50 left in the first quarter, back on Flymount Sports Network and Friday Night Glory. Looks like the Jaguars are going to go for it here on fourth down and six. Averett is going to get the snap. He's going to drop back. Dumps it off to Afaini, and Afaini's got room to run. He gets all the way down to the 16-yard line. First down, Jaguars. Huge play there to prolong this drive and give the Jaguars a shot in the red zone to tack on another touchdown.
Jaguars doing a great job here. A great play call by the OC, Scott Grantham, to give the ball off to Afaini. And even better vision there from from Jackson Averett.
Another screen pass to Billy Sikori. He's going to try and put the moves on number 13, the cornerback, Christian Neely. But Neely shoves him out a little bit.
That was a huge fourth down play. You were in that uncomfortable position where you may not be confident in your kicker from this far, but they were confident in their offense and a great play.
It's going to be a QB draw there by Jackson Averett, and he's going to do a phenomenal job to be taken down further downfield. So instead of getting pushed back and losing yardage, he gets tackled forward, and so he gets an extra yard there. It will now be third down and three on the 9-yard line here. Uzuwehi in the backfield. Averett really good at that hard count. He sits there and really tries to catch those defensive linemen for LD Bell off guard.
If you watch them, they do move a little bit, the LD Bell linemen, but they do a good job of not crossing that line.
Uzuwehi in motion, and he will trip on the exchange from Jackson Averett, and that will be...
It looks like he tripped over Jackson Averett because Averett just waited too long to... I think he wanted to pull it, but waited too long to make that decision. And now we have Josh Grant on to kick the field goal. This is
a morale booster here. This is a... I'd say make it or break it for him. This is
29-yard field goal here. And I'm very confident in Josh Grant.
I'm super confident,
right,
too. What a phenomenal kicker. And he buries it through the uprights. That could have been made from 55 yards with authority. Josh Grant puts the Jaguars up now 10-7 with 2:17 left in this first quarter. Jaguars got to be happy with getting points there. Definitely a little disappointing that they did not capitalize on the phenomenal field position and getting a touchdown. But it is what it is. They will have the lead here ending the first quarter. Hey, let's talk about how the Jaguars played there. Not necessarily as well on the offensive side as the first drive, but a few good plays there, and obviously that fourth down conversion that they had allowed them to get that 3 points and retake the lead.
Yeah, they started with a great field position, so right away you were thinking, all right, let's get a touchdown here, but you can't complain. You got points on the board. You're in the lead. 2 minutes to play here in the first quarter, and you're up 10-7, and you're confident in this defense. There's nothing more you can complain about.
This presentation is brought to you by Flower Mound Sports Network, heard live on Friday Night Glory. Hayden, we're actually being heard in Budapest. I tell you what, that is so cool to be able to broadcast this game all around the world for some parents and family members that can't make it to the game. You know, this is the mindset that we had when they came to us with this idea, and so happy to see that it is working out as well as it is. I'm super proud of the team that we put together.
Yeah, it's awesome. If you're in Budapest right now, we thank you for listening, and stay tuned. It's going to be awesome. Josh Grant goes ahead and buries one into the back of the end zone for another touchback. That's 3 in a row for him.
And we'll see how the Jaguars change their game plan kicking into the wind, because we saw that LD Bell didn't even want to mess with kicking it down to the 10-yard line. They went with the little pooch kick to about the 35, and you know, we'll see what Coach Basil and the special teams is going to work up here in the second half whenever the Jaguars are kicking into the wind. It will be a handoff for LD Bell. Some shifty moves there by the running back, and it will result in about 3 yards of... Check that 4-yard gain there for the LD Bell Blue Raiders.
That was number 26, Terry Pace, his first carry of the night, and it was a decent one.
Austin Brookham will get the snap. He's going to fake, and he will throw the pass. That was to number 11, the wide receiver Edgar Rodriguez, on a little 5-yard slant there that will result in a first down for LD Bell. They're technically first one of the game. Now, obviously, they had that really long touchdown on their last drive, but that is their first converted first down of this game.
And they're rocking those North Carolina-esque uniforms, the baby blue with the White, it's a good look.
Oh, they're beautiful. They are beautiful. It will be a handoff there to number 23 for LD Bell as number 24 for the Jaguars. That was Alec Brooks came in and sent Ivan Traylor flying into the LD Bell bench there. Traylor, not a very big guy, probably doesn't weigh a whole lot, but he can run very quick and very shifty for a running back.
Traylor, their leading rusher this year, has run for 48 yards and is averaging 6 yards per carry, which is a pretty solid stat, and 6 touchdowns.
And I tell you what, I just thought of this, but this offense that LD Bell is running is deathly similar to what Ulis Trinity runs with their triple option. So I think that Coach Basil, I mean, he has got to be thinking that this is a great, and that as a flag on the play, it looks like it's going to be a as a false start for LD Bell. As Brookham is going to get the snap, and he's going to hand it off to Traylor again. But like I was saying, this offense is very, very similar to what Ulis Trinity will be running whenever we play them later in the season, and that is a really, really, really solid team that if the Jaguars can pick up a win here at Neil E. Wilson Stadium against the Trinity Trojans, then, you know, that is looking like the Jaguars, you know, could have a very good chance of making the playoffs. So we'll see how this defense plays against this offense and how they can handle the triple option here, because I think that they will be able to use this as their advantage as Brookham is going to roll out and he's going to pass it. And that was a great snag there from number 2, Ricky Walden. That was the wide receiver that scored that very long touchdown, but he was lit up by Matt Greenwood in the secondary. And that's going to be a first down, gain of about 20 yards for LD Bell.
LD Bell now at their own 48-yard line as the clock is ticking down. 20 seconds left here in the first quarter, and they're going to try and get one or two more plays off. Looks like just one.
Jaguars lead the LD Bell Raiders 10-7 here with 8 seconds left in this first quarter. Looks like LD Bell is going to get one more play in, and they're going to hand it off to Traylor. He's going to get stopped at the 49-yard line, and that is going to take us to the end of the first quarter. Jaguars lead 10-7 back with the second quarter of action on Flyermon Sports Network and Friday Night Glory.
And that's the end of the first quarter with the score of Jaguars 10, Raiders 7. Flyermon fans in District 5-6A volleyball action tonight. The Flyermon Lady Jags defeated LD Bell in straight sets.
It's the start of second quarter here for the Jaguars as Brookham is going to keep it and he will get swallowed up by the Jaguar defense. First contact came from number 17 for the Jaguars. That is Davis Frondorf. He was the defensive special teams player of the week last week. Kudos to Davis Frondorf for the phenomenal performance he put on, stopping the offensive special teams players for Byron Nelson. Brookham is going to keep it. He's going to throw a little dish there to, looks like number 40 for LD Bell, Tyler Massel. Tyler Massel there is going to make the catch, and it will now be fourth down and 8 on the 50-yard line for LD Bell.
Want to go ahead and give a shout-out to Brandon Baku, who won WFAA Player of the Week this week with over 35,000 votes. That's right, you heard that correctly. Congratulations to him. That's a huge achievement.
That is a huge achievement. And it is going to be a high snap, and Brookham is going to handle it well. He's going to sky this punt, though. And it is going to take a member bounce for the Jaguars all the way. Look at that backspin. We love that backspin. Hit at the 32-yard line, and it is going to go all the way down to the 39-yard line. 7 yards of backspin there for the Jaguars' favor, and that is where they are going to take over on this third offensive possession. 2 for 2, creating scoring drives and looking to make it 3 for 3, extending their three-point lead.
All three drives starting with great field position, and again here starting from their own 39-yard line. Great field position again with 10 minutes, 36 seconds left in the first half. The Jaguars lead 10-7 and looking to increase that lead right here.
Averett in the shotgun. Two wide receivers to the near side. Jake Welch, the lone wide receiver, to the far side. They're going to hand it off to Afaini. He is going to break a tackle. He's going to find a gap. He is all the way down to the 41-yard line. That is a 27-yard run there for Afaini, and he is going to give the Jaguars a first down. Now into LD Bell territory here, looking to strike yet again.
Afaini, we saw it in the WTY game how dynamic he is, and again, this game he just looks amazing.
Averett is going to pull the run play, and he is going to dish it off to Jack Miller. Miller is going to get all the way down to the 23-yard line. Looks like they're going to call the spot a little bit further back. Coach Basil is down there in the official's ear saying he was not out at the 23-yard line. And that's where they're going to spot him, excuse me, at the 24-yard line. Another fire on first down here with 10:05 left in the second quarter. Jaguars lead 10-7. Averett in the shotgun. He's going to get the snap. He's going to look to pass. Pump fake. He's going to throw deep to Billy Sikora. Nobody within 3 paces of him. Averett overthrew him. Billy didn't even get his hands on that one, and that is definitely a missed opportunity for this Jaguar offense.
Jack Miller, we saw him a couple plays ago with that big play. He's been one of the most consistent players for the Jaguars.
Screen pass to Welch. Welch is going to get a block from Afaini. He is going to muscle his way. Still going to the 15-yard line. Did not like that he was tackled after he had stepped out of bounds. It's going to be a gain of 9 for the Jaguars. 3rd down and 1 here for Flower Mound, looking to convert on this very big 3rd down play.
Looked like he tackled him onto the track right there. So interesting no call there, but the ref showing his position on it by using the no call.
We got lone coverage out on the outside. Afaini is going to be untouched, high stepping it into the end zone. Touchdown, Jaguars, 16-7.
This O-line doing a great job of creating a huge hole for Afaini, and nobody within 2 arms lengths from him. And that is an easy touchdown for the Jaguars. Afaini, his first touchdown of the game.
And you could see one of the offensive linemen for the Jaguars, such good blocking that he couldn't even find a LD Bell player to block. And Josh Grant is going to nail that one through the uprights. Jaguars now lead 17-7, 9:49 left in this first half. We'll be back with the kickoff here on Flower Mound Sports Network and Friday Night Glory.
All those urgent care places you drive by every day, they do look all the same, but only one of them consistently wins the best of awards year after year. Only one of them has all those jerseys from the local high school teams because those players sure need patching up more than most. And only one place has the same great doctors that stick around because they love their patients. That place? Rapid Med, your hometown family doctors with big ol' hearts right here at the corner of Justin and Chinchapel Road.
Kicking off for the Jaguars, number 46.
Jaguars lead 17-7, 9:49 left in the first half of play here at beautiful Neil E. Wilson Stadium alongside Hayden Bumpus. I'm Shepard Branch. Clayton Stewart out to kick off for the Jaguars. He has been the deep ball provider for the Jaguars, and he will now be kicking into this wind. He's going to give it a good whirl, and LD Bell will catch it at the 15-yard line. A block from LD Bell, and number two is going to get out to the outside, but he will be stopped at the 24-yard line. Ran about 50 yards there to get 24 yards, and that is where LD Bell will start their offensive possession.
And you could see this wind is just having a huge factor on the ball as he, Clayton Stewart, one of the longest kickers I've ever seen, puts a big boot on it, and it only flies to about the 15-yard line. Excuse me, probably the 10-yard line. But again, like we said, this wind, a huge factor in today's game. And right now, the Blue Raiders with the advantage. Going downwind.
LD Bell, four wide receivers, two to each side. They're going to fake the handoff, throwing a screen to 14, and he will be tackled there by number 24, Alec Brooks, for the Jaguars. Good play there to make sure that they wrap up and minimize the damage there as a good block on the outside from LD Bell. That play could have gone for a little bit longer than just 3 yards.
That was number 14, DeCalvis Butler, the senior wide receiver who looked like he had a decent amount of room, but was spoiled quickly by the Jaguar defense.
Brookham is going to be surrounded on either side. Left running back is going to go in motion, and he will throw a screen to that running back. He will find space, taken out at the 26-yard line, hit into one of our wonderful trainers on the sidelines. That was number 23, Ivan Traylor, for LD Bell, and that will result in a first down.
Ivan Traylor, like we said, the best running back for LD Bell. They have a few. We've seen Terry Pace. We've seen Ivan Traylor and one other. I can't remember his name, but they brought out that, what did you call it?
The triple option.
Triple option with three running backs.
Looks like they're going to go with one on this play, two wide receivers to each side, and Brookham is going to hand it off to Traylor, and Traylor is going to be hit at the line of scrimmage. That was number 62 for the Jaguars, Mark Mateen.
68 actually was the one on the tackle. That was Daryl Rutherford. Sorry about that, Shepard. Had
it's
to correct you.
I got bad eyes.
But a great play by Daryl Rutherford, the two-year starter for the Jaguars, for that phenomenal defensive line.
Brookham is going to keep it. He will drop back to throw a screen pass, and that was Daryl Rutherford all over it. And he's fired up.
And he should be. That was a phenomenal play to see that the quarterback was going to dump it off to the running back and just really light him up pretty good.
Yeah, they sniffed that play out super quick, like it was a big steak. Tell you what, that will result in a third down and 10 for LD Bell. They have yet to convert on a third down play so far tonight. Jaguars trying to stop them again.
The only third down that they actually did convert on was the touchdown, but I don't know if you technically count that.
And that will be thrown into the ground. That was pass intended for number 40, Tyler Massel. And that will be a fourth down for LD Bell. A great third down stop there for the Jaguar defense.
Number 28, Sterling Deary, back to receive the punt. One of the dynamic punt returner, kick returner that we have. Him and Ryan Johnson, a great duo on the kick return. He's also a phenomenal cornerback for us.
Cole Adkins is going to be punting now for LD Bell, and Sterling Deary calls for the fair catch, and you know he had a lot of room to be able to run and return that one, but just wasn't feeling it, I guess, and he will have the fair catch at the 28-yard line, and that is where the Jaguars will take over the ball with a 10-point lead, 17-7, over the LD Bell Blue Raiders with 8:07 left in the first half. This broadcast is brought to you by Fly Around Sports Network and streaming live on Friday Night Glory alongside Hayden Bumpus. I'm Shepard Branch. Hayden, it's been a wonderful night so far. Jaguars with the lead, looking to tack on more points here. 3 points, 7 points. They'll take anything right now. Just being able to extend this lead is all Coach Basil has got to be worried about.
Yeah, starting from their own 28-yard line, this is their worst field position of the day, and it's not awful.
Hand off to Afaini, and he's going to run up the middle to the 31-yard line. Gain of 3, now second down and 7 for the Jaguars. Going with the no-huddle offense here.
The LD Bell defense only allowing 22.8 points per game, so we'll say 23 points per game. The Jaguars with a touchdown would already surpass that in the first half, which would be pretty impressive.
We talked about earlier how this LD Bell defense just has kept them in any game that they have been playing so far. As Averett is going to roll out, he's calling for one of his wide receivers, but he is going to take it himself. Running out of bounds. And he will get a gain of no yards. It will now be third down and 7 from the 31-yard line.
7:26 left in the half. A first down would be nice here for the Jaguars to keep the ball moving.
Two wide receivers to the near side, two to the far side. Looks like they're going to put Max Wadding, the tight end, in the slot on the far side. Afaini will be to the right of Averett. Jaguars looking to convert this third down and 7. Averett is going to drop back. He's going to dump it off to Afaini. Afaini's going to have room to run. He is going to try and break the tackle, but a phenomenal play there by number 16 for LD Bell. That is Kevin Pabon, and he will stop Afaini who's away. He in his tracks. It will now be fourth down and 3, and the Jaguars are going to bring Josh Grant out to punt.
First time tonight we've seen Josh Grant out for the punt team, and the LD Bell Blue Raiders have two receivers or cornerbacks back to receive the punt, and that is number 15, Derek Thomas, and I cannot see the other one, but two back to receive the punt.
And they're back there pretty good for a win like that, and it is going to take a big bounce, and nice kick there for the Jaguars as one of the LD Bell players thought about grabbing it, but he chose not to. That was Ricky Walton back to return the punt as well as the other player that you previously mentioned, and they will start now at the 25-yard line. Jaguars looking to get another defensive stop here. One play for the Jaguars that cost them 7 points to the LD Bell Blue Raiders, and they've played flawlessly since other than one play, and I think that defensive coordinator will continue to preach that to them and keep them in the right mindset of, hey, you guys are playing flawlessly so far. Let's keep that going throughout this game.
That defensive coordinator being Brian Vardaman, a good guy and a great coach.
They're going to hand it off to the running back, and Connor Lee is going to come from the secondary to make the tackle untouched, and he is fired up. That was number 26 for LD Bell. Terry Pace didn't have great blocking there, and it showed as Connor Lee migrated to the ball and made the tackle there for a loss of 1.
And a special thanks to Connor Lee and Jackson Averett last night. Did our job at the freshman game and did a phenomenal job, and they had a blast doing it, it seemed like.
Brookham in the backfield. He will get the snap, and he is going to roll out to his left looking for a wide receiver. Connor Lee on the chase, and he's going to throw it to number 2. That was Walton, and it looks like a flag is coming in from goodness gracious. That is the Jaguar 45-yard line that official threw that flag from.
Interesting that he saw this penalty from how far away he was, but I will give him props for a great throw from the 40 to the other 40.
But yeah, that was an impressive throw, but tell you what, an eye doctor with LASIK would have been hard to try and see that throw, I tell you what.
And that's pass interference on the Jaguars. Not sure where he saw that, but it's his game to call, and it's his decision.
Unbelievable, but there was actually an official that was right there at the play, chose not to throw the flag, and he threw the flag as the back line judge, but it is what it is. Brookham's going to throw a screen pass to 14 from LD Bell. That is DeCalvis Butler there. And it will result in a gain of 1 second down to nine now for the Blue Raiders.
We've seen this Jaguar linebacker grouping with Connor Lee and who else?
Alec Brooks.
Alec Brooks, David Evans. Just very solid. And your backups, David Lawrence, a massive guy, a great player.
They're going to hand it off to Walton, and it looks like Grant Antrim is on the chase, and he can't get it, and Walton is just running through the defense for the Jaguars.
Antrim had a hold of his jersey and could have stopped him for a loss of 2 or 3 yards, but missed the tackle, and then Walton running into his own quarterback, running into 4 or 5 of our players, but didn't
like
go down.
Like a machine, like a pinball machine. He was just bouncing off everybody, trying to get as much yardage as he could, and he resulted in positive yardage there. It will now be 3rd down and 5. Big 3rd down stop coming from the Jaguars, hopefully.
Luke McFarlane on the sideline doing a good job of pumping the crowd up.
And that is going to be a screen pass stopped by the cornerback for the Jaguars. Looked like that was number 23, Michael Haney, on the coverage there. Little screen pass from the backfield to Pace, and he got tackled for a loss of 4 yards there. It will now be 4th down and 9 with 4:35 left in the first half. Jaguars lead 17-7.
Jaguars haven't let the LD Bell offense pass half field since that touchdown. So Jaguar defense just playing phenomenal so far.
Low punt, and it is going to get a great kick. Still rolling past the 20 all the way down to the 13-yard line. That is about, he kicked that from about the 30 all the way to the opposing 13. That is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, about 56 yards there. A great punt with some extra roll, and the Jaguars will start at their own 12-yard line. Alongside Hayden Bumpus, I'm Shepard Branch. This is Flyermount Sports Network and Friday Night Glory's coverage of your Flyermount Jaguars. Jaguars lead 17-7, 4:09 left in the first half. And this offense is out to score some more points and extend that Jaguar lead.
The LD Bell Blue Raiders have gone with that low punt all night. And it's risky because if it gets to the returner, he can take that in stride and get a good pickup, but it's also at an advantage because you're going to get forward rollout, and it's probably going to go pretty deep.
Averett gets the snap. He's going to hand it off to Afaini. That is number 53 for LD Bell. Eric Heron, the senior defensive lineman who had first contact on the running back. Be a gain of 1 yard, 2nd down and 9 now for the Jaguars from the 13.
Looking for Averett to pass here soon. He hasn't thrown a lot tonight, but Zach Welch and Jake Welch, that brother duo, are both going on in solo, one-on-one coverage. So look for them to make a big play here.
Jaguars still yet to test this secondary, and they're going to do so. They're going to throw a little slant pass to Jack Miller, and Jack Miller still not brought down. He is all the way down to the 32-yard line. That is going to be a gain from the 13 to the 32 of 29 yards there, if my math is correct.
I believe that it's correct.
We'll go with it. But it's down to the 33-yard line, and that was a gain of, 20 yards there for the Jaguars in two plays getting that first down.
Jack Miller, one of the most effective players for the Jaguars, making a big play there.
And pass to Jake Welch, and Jake Welch is going to be in stride. He breaks a tackle. He's got room to run. He cuts back all the way down to the 23-yard line. First down, Jaguars.
Averett right here. You can see it here. Averett doing a phenomenal job of threading the needle, and Jake Welch is weaving in and out of people. And a phenomenal pickup. Jake Welch, a phenomenal receiver and a very quick player.
Averett's going to hand it off to Afaini. He's going to make a few cuts. He's going to get tackled for a gain of 4 yards there to the 18-yard line. Jaguars now inside the red zone here, trying to extend this lead to 24, hopefully. Two wide receivers to the near side, two to the far side of Finney in the backfield. Averett is going to fake the handoff. He's going to throw the screen to Miller, and it looks like there will be a flag on the play, possibly a roughing of the passer.
2 minutes, 9 seconds left in the first half, and it will be a roughing the passer call, and that's a good call from the ref, keeping that quarterback safe, Jackson Averett.
And it's not like he can't take the hit. It just really helps whenever they come in late and getting that extra first down yardage is that will be a – yes, roughing the passer. I think it's a extra 10 yards and the first down. And that will move them inside the 10-yard line.
That the second penalty for the LD Bell Blue Raiders. They had one on the first play of the game, actually before the first play of the game. But that is their second one. So now 15 yards total for penalties for the LD Bell Blue Raiders.
Jaguars now inside the 10-yard line on the 8. It will be first and goal and some miscommunication here from the officials. Looks like the LD Bell coach did not like that call one bit. He voiced his opinion to the head official. And play will resume. Averett in the shotgun. Going to go with that hard call there. Nobody bit, and so he will look to the sidelines for the play. Two wide receivers to the near side, two stacked up on the far side. And they're going to fake it to a Finney, and they're going to pass it to a wide open Zach Welch in the end zone. Touchdown, Jaguars!
That is Zach Welch's second touchdown this year, the leading receiver for the Jaguars. And you can watch right here, Averett, seeing that they didn't go for the hard count and using that audible, and as he takes the snap, Zach Welch running a phenomenal route and a beautiful pass from Jackson Averett. Really not a hard one, though, because Zach Welch with nobody on him.
And that was a blocked kick there from LD Bell. They're going to try and pick it up and score 2 points. Guy's still running, but he will not make it all the way. Can't fault anybody but the offensive line there for letting that player get through, and we'll get a replay here of just exactly what happened.
Let's see what happened, and it just looked like the O-line didn't really block anybody on the outside, and it was easy for them to get back there. It wasn't Josh Grant's fault. It looked like it was going to be a fine kick, but
looked like it was a case of that was your man, right? Wait, what are you talking about? No, that was your man.
Are you sure? That was your man.
No, I'm pretty sure that was your man. That's what we can only assume what is the conversation happening on the Flyermount sideline right now. Nevertheless, Jaguars lead 23-7, 1:45 left in this first half. We'll take a break and back with the kickoff on Flyermount Sports Network and Friday Night Glory. Back to action at Neil E. Wilson Stadium alongside Hayden Bumbus. I'm Shepard Branch. This is Flyermount Sports Network and Friday Night Glory's coverage of Flyermount Jaguar football. Clayton Stewart is going to kick it very low, and it will go out of bounds. A flag will be dropped, and LD Bell will start with fairly decent field position here to try and march down the field with only a minute and 45 seconds left. Hayden, let's talk about how the Jaguars have played so far. A 23-7 lead, LD Bell averaging 23 points a game given up. Their defense has played very well throughout the season, but the Jaguars have been able to pick it apart. LD Bell looks like they don't have an answer.
Yeah, we've already surpassed the average points per game that the Raiders allow, and we're going to come close to what we're averaging. We're averaging 30.6 points per game. We're already at 23 here in the first half as there's a minute 45 left. But it's been this defense that's played so great so far. Just one miscommunication, and that's where that 7 points came from.
And nothing short of what we have expected from this defense. They have played very well throughout the season, keeping this team in some very close games that we ended up not coming out on the winning end. But we knew that as long as this defense could keep on playing well, that this offense would catch fire like the Flower Mound offense always does, as Brandon McCoo backs his man all the way up, and he is going to take the quarterback down. Austin Brookham has no answer, and Baku is going to sack him for a loss of, holy cow, that's got to be a loss of about 20 yards.
And Baku, you can see it there, didn't need to even get rid of his blocker, still got to the quarterback, and that's why he was the WFAA Player of the Week last week, because of plays like that, and wow.
Living up to the name, Brandon Baku, the beast on the offensive line, and he gets juked out there, but a great play by, that is number 24 for the Jaguars, Alec Brooks coming from the outside and picking up the trash on that one, and he cleans it up, and that will be third down and 27 with a minute left in the first half. LD Bell is going to take a Flyer Mound, check that, is going to take a timeout. We'll take it with them. Jaguars lead 23-7, 1 minute left in the first half on Flyer Mound Sports Network and Friday Night Glory.
Ashley from Argyle worried more about seeing a new doctor than the finger she just broke playing volleyball.
Ashley loves Dr. Gomez.
Which is why mom took her to Rapid Med. Again, sure there's a slew of places that say they're urgent care, but to Ashley's mom, urgent means making her daughter comfortable while getting the very best care.
My daughter is worth it.
Rapid Med, hometown family doctors with Texas-sized hearts at the corner of Justin and Chinchapel Road.
LD Bell in the shotgun, they're going to get the snap, looking to pass. Jaguars bring the blitz, and it will be overthrown of the LD Bell receiver there. Good defense by Connor Lee, stepping back into a coverage role as a middle linebacker, and fourth down in 24 now with 56 seconds left. And I tell you what, just thinking about this right now, LD Bell could have ran the ball there and tried to siphon as much clock as they could, chose to throw, incomplete pass stops the clock, and now the Jaguars have 56 seconds, which is more than enough time for this offense to put together a drive and score at least 3 points here.
And if they go with this low punt again, Sterling Deary could get it and take this for a big return.
And it will be a low punt. Deary's going to take it. He will be hit immediately as he touches the ball, and he will be downed at the 49-yard line there. But the Jaguars, 47 seconds to march 49 yards and score at least 3 points. You know, just a pitch and a catch from Jackson Markham to, let's see, Jake Welch, Zach Welch, Billy Sakura, Fainu Zawahi. I mean, I could sit here and name people all day of who could catch this ball.
Jackson Averett, I think you mean.
Jackson Averett, pitch and catch. Well, no, what did I say?
Jackson Markham.
Did I say Jackson Markham?
Who that is?
Oh, goodness. Jackson Markham, kid who I used to play golf with. Jackson Averett can pitch and catch.
Jackson Markham
plays at SMU right now. He is a very talented golfer.
If you're listening, Jackson Markham,
you're welcome.
This is your shout-out.
This is your shout-out. That's exactly right. Jackson Averett is the quarterback for the Jaguars, and he will be facilitating this offense, and he's going to throw a little screen pass to Afaini. Smart play to get out of bounds, not having to use a timeout there. It's going to be a gain of 1 yard, second down and 9 for the Jaguars. Gosh, that's the first time I've done that all season.
That's okay.
It's all right. Hey, there's a first for everything.
There is a first for everything.
Jaguars have not scored to end a half. Let's make that a first.
I just want to put some points on the board here, give us a more comfortable lead than we have right now. And
tell you what, there's nothing happier as a coach than going into halftime after a great score. They're going to hand it. Check that. Averett's going to keep it. He is going to run to the outside. He's going to lower the shoulder, get all the way to the 40-yard line. Now 30 seconds left, and it looks like the Jaguars are going to have to take their final timeout. 31 seconds left. We will take the timeout with them. Jaguars lead 23-7. 31 seconds left in the first half. Back after this. Back to action at Neil E. Wilson Stadium alongside Hayden Bumpus. I'm Shepard Branch. 31 seconds left for the Jaguars to try and score. Averett is going to keep it. He's going to run to the outside. Smart play to get out of bounds at the 35-yard line. First down, stopping the clock. 26 seconds left for the Jaguars to score before halftime.
I hope they try and take a chance here at the end zone on this first down play. Worst that could happen is it goes incomplete and 25 seconds probably on the clock. Or, no, probably 20 seconds. But
nevertheless, I'd love to see a shot too. I think that they got a chance at here. Averett's got the arm, and that looks like what they're going to do. They're going to throw a short pass, almost intercepted. That was tipped by number 53 for LD Bell. Great play by Eric Heron. And an incomplete pass does stop the clock. It will now be second down and 10, 22 seconds left for the Jaguars.
Took a shot. The worst thing that could happen, I said.
Well, that wasn't even necessarily a shot. That was more of like a little slant pass looking for the yards in the first down. But I'd love to see them go to the outside to Jake Welch here and really take a shot. And it looks like they're just going to throw it to the sideline to Zach Welch and tried to get out of bounds, but he could not do so. It is first down, but that will stop the clock until they spot it. And they're going to need to go quick here because the clock is running. 10 seconds left. Averett looks like they're going to get one more playoff, and they're going to spike the ball. Smart play there. It will now be second down and 10 with 8 seconds left in the first half.
You're not confident where you are right now for a field goal because you're straight into the wind, and this is strong winds today. You have a phenomenal kicker in Josh Grant and Clayton Stewart possibly for the long ball, but the accuracy with the wind, you never know what's going to happen. So looking for a long play as the officials have a discussion, not sure what about. It is second and 10 from the LD Bell 25-yard line with 8 seconds to play. Averett looking for the play call.
Now, I wasn't even thinking about that Averett is also throwing into the wind, so it, you know, I mean, a 25-yard pass is not easy, especially into a dead wind. But it looks like that's what he's going to do. He's going to throw it up to Zach Welch, and Zach Welch is going to come down with it! Touchdown, Jaguars! 3 seconds left in the first half. What a great scoring drive.
Averett right here taking the snap, taking his time, and he launches this one. A beautiful pass, and Zach Welch, an amazing adjustment to get past the cornerback and make a phenomenal catch. And Zach Welch, the phenomenal receiver. That's his second touchdown of the game. And wow, what a way to end this first half. Still 3 seconds on the clock.
And this Jaguar offense has got to have all the confidence in the world. 30 points in the first half, ending on a touchdown going in to halftime. And Josh Grant tacks on the extra point. Now 30-7, 3 seconds left in the first half. They had 47 seconds left to go from the 49-yard line. Only needed 44 of it. Jaguars now lead 30-7, and they are rolling here in this district matchup against Hurst LD Bell.
This is a huge game. Me and Shepard were talking about it earlier. If we win this game and go and win two more games in district, you're looking at a playoff-bound Flower Mound Jaguar team, and we haven't been able to say that in a long time.
And that has been the goal the whole season. We got to talk to Coach Basil earlier in the season, and, you know, this team just has playoff on the mind. Obviously, you got to take it game by game. But, you know, it looked very promising after that dissembling of W.T. White in the first game, 65-14, and then, you know, three straight losses. This team was on its heels, but they came out and got it done against Byron Nelson, and they are putting it to LD Bell. And, man, 30-7 going into halftime. As a Jaguar coach, as a Jaguar player, and as a Jaguar fan, you are so pleased, especially with this being the wonderful homecoming game.
That's right. Josh Grant on the kick this time, assuming they'll go with a squib kick so that the Blue Raiders don't have an opportunity to throw a Hail Mary.
And might even have him on there for his defensive power. As LD Bell will take it at the 10-yard line, and they're going to get stopped at the 20-yard line, and that will take us into halftime. Jaguars lead 30-7, back with the second half of play here on Flower Mound Sports Network and Friday Night Glory. Stay with us.
All those urgent care places you drive by every day, they do look all the same, but only one of them consistently wins the best of awards year after year. Only one of them has all those jerseys from the local high school teams because those players sure need patching up more than most. And only one place has the same great doctors that stick around because they love their patients. That place? Rapid Med, your hometown family doctors with big ol' hearts right here at the corner of Justin and Chinchapel Road.
Back with the second half of action here at Neil E. Wilson Stadium alongside Hayden Bumpus and his phenomenal air guitar. I'm Shepard Branch. Jaguars will receive the ball to start the second half, and they will be receiving the ball with a 30-7 lead.
Yeah, phenomenal performance from defense and offense. Defense really playing flawlessly. That 7 points that you heard us say was off one miscommunication, and they had a big 79-yard touchdown. But other than that, I don't even know if they've gotten a first down since then. I know they definitely haven't gotten past the 50.
It has been a shutdown performance from the defense. Nothing that we haven't seen all season, but this offense has been instrumental in maintaining this Jaguar lead, as there was an unsportsmanlike conduct penalty on the Jaguars, and LD Bell will be kicking off from the Jaguars 45-yard line. So it will be a 15-yard penalty, and looks like the Jaguars will go with 10 players in the first 20 yards as LD Bell is going to try and squib kick, and they're going to kick it, onside, but they're going to kick it right to number 44, Connor Lee, on the hands team, and the Jaguars will start on the 35-yard line, great field position to start the second half.
The Blue Raiders could have pinned them back and really put them at about their 25-yard line with the touchback easy because of the unsportsmanlike penalty. Went for the onside to try and get something going, but Connor Lee there, not a great onside kick.
And I mean, it went right to him. It was, not very well executed by any means. Jackson Averett is going to lead the offense out on the field. We will have two receivers to each side, and they will be stacked up on each other. Finney to the right, and a lot of movement, but no snappage of the ball. And it will be a false start on the offense that will move them back 5 yards. First down and 15 for the Jaguars to start this first half. Second half.
Jackson Averett, I believe, played his best half of football last half. Threw the ball phenomenally, threw a few great passes, ending with that 30-yard touchdown pass to Zach Welch. Really, he's just looked great today.
And they will go with the same formation here. Probably going to run the same play, and there will fake the pass to Finney. They're going to throw the screen pass to Billy Sikora. He's going to break a tackle. Great block by Jake Welch and Billy Sikora to the 20, to the 15, the 10. Touchdown, Jaguars!
There is a very late flag, and I assume it's going to be a block in the back on Jake Welch. Very late call. Don't know that I agree with it, but here's the play. Averett doing a good job of developing this play and a great job breaking the tackle, and then there was the block right there. They really set up the whole play, but that's what they're going to go back for. They're going to call a block in the back, and that flag came in when Sikor was about at the 25-yard line. So a late flag, but a good play. Disappointing that it has to come back. And it's a 10-yard penalty, and that's going to put them back to their own 27-yard line. 28-yard line. It'll be first down and 17 yards.
What a great offensive play there by the Jaguars. Great move for Billy Sikora to break that first tackle, and just an unfortunate call there. The block in the back, but the Jaguars will try and work from it as Afani finds a hole. He's going to get hit at the 32-yard line. That will be a gain of 4 yards. Now is going to be about second down and 13 from the 28-yard line for the Jaguars. Averett going to motion Afani. He's looking down the field to Billy Sikora in the middle of the field, and he is going to get all the way to the 45-yard line, and that is going to result in a first down for your Flyermount Jaguars.
Billy Sikora having a great game today. He has a touchdown already, and we've seen a couple of great screen plays, a couple deep passes to him, and he's really a dynamic player for this Flyermount offense.
They're going to throw a screen to Jake Welch, and Afani is going to get a good block there. Welch is going to get a gain of, they're going to give him 10 yards on the play, and I think that that's going to be another first down for the Jaguars.
Jake Welch, we said, one of the fastest players on this team, and they will give him the first down. And it's first and 10 from the LD Bell 45-yard line.
Averett's going to stick with the pass. He's going to Johnny Manziel. He's looking downfield. He's going to throw it off to Billy Sikora. Sikora's going to get hit at the 40-yard line. That will be a gain of 5 yards, second down and 5 for the Jaguars. Jaguars going with a lot of passes in a row. They see that the secondary for LD Bell is struggling to try and cover these talented wide receivers. And, you know, Coach Grantham is just, you know, trying to exploit the defense as much as he can. And that means passing. And they're going to pass again. Averett's going to throw it down the middle of the field. And Billy Sikora, it slides right through his hands. Good coverage there by number 13, Christian Neely, the defensive back, a senior for LD Bell. And there's a hurt player on the field for LD Bell. We're going to go and take a break as the trainers tend to him back with coverage 30-7. Jaguars lead 10-18 left in the third quarter.
Ashley from Argyle worried more about seeing a new doctor than the finger she just broke playing volleyball.
Ashley loves Dr. Gomez.
Which is why mom took her to Rapid Med. Again, sure, there's a slew of places that say they're urgent care, but to Ashley's mom, urgent means making her daughter comfortable while getting the very best care.
My daughter is worth it.
Rapid Med, hometown family doctors with Texas-sized hearts at the corner of Justin and Chinchapel Road.
Bring us back. And we're back to action at Neil E. Wilson Stadium. That was number 74, Tevita Ahio, who was injured on the play. He walked off gingerly with a pretty bad limp, so we hope to see him again. Hope he's okay. Never want to see a player get out of the game because of injury.
Absolutely not. Averett is going to motion a finding. They're going to pass it again. Going to throw it to the intended receiver was Jake Welch. That was number 9 for LD Bell. Ricky Tattoo.
Tattoo or Tatu? I like Tatu. That's fun to say.
Yeah, because Tattoo, now that I'm saying it, is actually, it sounds like a tattoo. Tatu. That was Ricky Tatu, the linebacker who broke up that pass, and it will now be fourth down for the Jaguars. A little bit too long for a field goal, even though I think Josh Grant would be able to poke one in there, being downwind, but they're going to go and punt it, try and pin LD Bell back. As number 19 for the Jaguars, that was Addison Nilprofan. Just didn't get the call, I guess, and jumped offsides very, very quickly. Only helps the Jaguars, though. Makes it a little bit easier for Josh Grant punting downwind to be able to tuck this one back there.
Josh Grant can boot the punt, that's for sure.
With the boot. As those footballers like to say.
He's also great at controlling his distance, and it's a fake.
And he's going to have room to run. Josh Grant has one person to beat, and he runs over the returner, number 15. And I tell you what, Josh Grant can really use that speed. He is one heck of an athlete.
You can see it right here. He takes the snap and just tucks it and runs, and he's just got all kinds of space and then just plummels over this guy. What a run from Josh Grant. He played wide receiver freshman year and in 7th and 8th grade. He is not just a kicker. He's an athlete.
I would say that him running top speed, there are a few people on this field that could touch him, and that's the stinking punter. What a great play call there from Coach Basil. Nobody, not even us, were expecting that. And it results in a big gain for the Jaguars. First down as they hand it off to a finding. He's going to find a gap. Going to make a few players miss, and he will get brought down at the 14-yard line.
And that was the first fake punt we've had all year.
This trickery from the Jaguars, it's so overwhelming. This is phenomenal.
You could say he bamboozled them.
He was bamboozled, that is for sure. That's 2 weeks in a row.
That was the second probably trick play we've seen all year. Last week we saw the screen pass and then pass to the wide receiver to receiver.
Heck, for all we know, there could have been other trick plays. They just tricked us so well. You ever thought about that?
I don't understand what you're saying.
It's a little bit too much thinking. Averett is going to drop back. He's going to throw it to Zach Welch, and Zach Welch is going to make the catch to the one-yard line.
Nearly Zach's third touchdown of the game. That would have been a hat trick. He's had one touchdown coming into this game and has two tonight and could have had his third there. And a phenomenal pass and catch from Jackson Averett to Zach Welch.
Averett's going to hand it off to Afaini. Afaini's going to get hit behind the line of scrimmage and driven all the way back to the 5-yard line. They're going to give him forward progress at the 2. Loss of 1 yard, but it will be second down and goal here for the Jaguars, trying to punch this one in and extend the lead to 37-7.
And when we thought that this drive wasn't really going to go anywhere, Basil shocks us again with the fake punt, and now a couple big plays, and we're on the 1 yard line about to punch in another touchdown.
And the Jaguars really utilizing those trick plays to their advantage as Averett's going to keep it, and that's going to be a touchdown. Jackson Averett faked us out up here in the booth. He will punch that one in. Jaguars now lead 36-7, 7:39 left in the third quarter. What a commanding lead by the Jaguars.
And that is Jackson Averett's 8th rushing touchdown of the year. That is an amazing stat. As Zach Welch lines up in the quarterback with one lineman, and they're going to go ahead and send out the point after touchdown unit, and that is Josh Grant, the phenomenal kicker.
And also runner.
And punt, fake punt expert. On to kick the extra point, and that is amazing wide receiver Billy Sakura on for the hold. This to make it 37-7, and it's straight through the middle of the uprights, and that is 37-7, 7:39 left in the third quarter. This is a beatdown.
This is great as a Jag fan. This is something that you always want to see as a Jaguar fan. Haven't been able to experience this type of satisfaction in the last couple seasons, but these Jaguars are doing such a great job.
You can watch right here. The play that set it all up was the fake punt. Josh Grant taking the snap and then making a couple moves and making people miss and then plummeling over somebody and getting that first down. That sparked this whole drive. And Josh Grant, like we said, not just a punter. He's a football player, and he's an athlete. And
he's having the game of his season so far. Has not missed from the kicking either an extra point or, as we tap on the wood here, try not to jinx it, he has not missed so far tonight. He has faced some scrutiny over the last couple days with his ability to kick the football, but, you know.
He's proved those haters wrong.
That's exactly right.
We had one blocked at extra point, but we said not his fault.
Definitely not. Not whenever nobody blocks him, you know.
Yeah, so nothing he could have done there. And he's back out there to kick off, going downwind, and I got a feeling he's just going to boot this one.
From the 40-yard line, Grant is going to kick this one, and it is going to go into the end zone through the back of the end zone. Jaguars lead 37-7. LD Bell will have the ball at their 25-yard line, trying to mount a comeback. Back here on Flymount Sports Network and Friday Night Glory. LD Bells will start at their own 25-yard line. Austin Brookham will hand it off. Jaguars will make this stop at the 28-yard line. That was first contact from number 41, Brandon Baku, and number 44, Connor Lee.
If you are a Blue Raider fan out there listening to us tonight, we understand that this has been a frustrating game for you guys. They haven't been able to move the ball really at all. And that's really focused around Connor Lee, Brandon Baku, and this D-line has just been phenomenal all night.
Eldie Bell player in movement. They're going to hand it off to him on the wide receiver jet sweep, and the Jaguars are going to swarm to the ball. Connor Lee and Brandon Baku, the two leaders of this defense, will be the ones to make the tackle, and that will be a loss of 5 yards. Now, third and 11 with 6:45 left in this third quarter. Jaguars lead the Eldie Bell Blue Raiders 37-7. Alongside Hayden Bumpus, I'm Shepard Branch. This is Flyermount Sports Network's coverage of your Flyermount Jaguars, streaming live on Friday Night Glory. It is a beautiful and cool October evening here in Flyermount, Texas. Brookham is going to throw it deep into double coverage. Out of bounds. That was number 7, Dakota Nielsen, trying to make the interception, trying to keep his feet in bounds like a wide receiver trying to make a catch, but he could not come up with it, and it will now be 4th down and 11. Looks like Eldie Bell is going to have to punt yet again.
And I'd like to go ahead and give a shout out. If you are listening in El Paso right now, we heard earlier Budapest and now El Paso. We thank you for listening. It's so cool to see from around the world people are listening, but also around the state of Texas. It's a lot of fun.
It's a low driven punt that will kick back to the 49-yard line before the Eldie Bell player emphatically jumps on it to keep the ball from moving. Jaguars will take over in phenomenal field position. Again, this offense has not missed a beat so far tonight. They have scored on almost every single possession tonight, throwing up 37 points so far, 30 points in the first half, and then that beautiful touchdown run by Jackson Averett. And Averett will be the one to lead the offense out onto the field again. We've got two wide receivers to the far side, one to the near side. Jack Miller, the tight end, is lined up on the offensive line.
Averett has really shown a lot of poise tonight in the pocket, letting plays develop. And this O-line has been a great job allowing that to happen.
And finally hits a hole between the blockers as he gets all the way down to the 39-yard line on the opposite side. That will be a gain of 12 yards for the Jaguars, resulting in a Flower Mound first down.
Like I was saying, Averett, very poised tonight. We've seen him grow every game and get better, and he just looks so comfortable there tonight. He looks like a veteran quarterback. Looks like he's been playing there for 3 years.
They're going to hand it off to Afani again. He's going to run into the offensive line, and they will push him all the way to the 36-yard line. Gain of 3 yards, now 2nd down and 7. 5:33 left in this third quarter. Jaguars lead 37-7. Averett will be in shotgun. Two wide receivers again to the far side, one to the near side. Yeah, speaking of Jackson Averett, he has done such a good job of leading this offense. It looks like everybody, no matter how old or how experienced they are, is buying into his play and how he is operating, and it is just a piece of art that we're looking at right now. All the moving parts are moving in secrecy right now.
Afani, the ball carrier there, as he took it and muscled his way for a first down. That was a 6-yard pickup, and it looks like he was about to get tackled for only about 3 yards, but muscled his way to it.
Averett again in the shotgun. He's going to hand it off to Afani. Afani's got blockers. He's got room to run. Gets all the way to the 20-yard line. And that is going to be a gain of 7 yards. Now 2nd down and 3 for the Jaguars. They're now, on the 21-yard line. They're 1 yard away from being in the red zone, which they have converted on every single try for at least 3 points. We're going to give it to Afani again, and he's going to be stopped for a loss. It's going to be a loss of 3 yards, 2 yards for the Jaguars. Now 3rd down and 7 coming up.
And we have listeners from El Paso. Like I said, that is the home of offensive coordinator Coach Scott Grantham. Awesome to have fans of him and fans of the Flyermount Jaguars listening. We thank you for following us on Twitter. Our Twitter handle is at the FMSN. So give us a follow and keep updated with the Jaguars.
And what a pass there from Jackson Averett. He threw it a little bit high for the intended receiver, Billy Sikora. He got hit from behind on that play by one of the safeties, and that was a incomplete pass, and they're going to bring Josh Grant out for the 40-yard field goal attempt. He will be kicking this one from the 30-yard line. And this is to make it a 42-7 game for the Jaguars.
Josh Grant downwind. And this one is straight through the uprights. No doubt about it. Josh Grant, he's just on today. Cannot miss. And that makes the score 40-7. 3:29 left in the third quarter. And Josh Grant again showing his ability, showing he is worthy of the number one kicker in the state.
You can definitely tell that he is playing with a chip on his shoulder. Talked to him before the game, and he was very, very determined. Definitely not pleased with how he had been kicking throughout the season, and knows that this is such a crucial time for him. Has not been signed yet, but definitely has a lot of colleges, Division I colleges, that are looking at him to be their place kicker, and he knows that, you know, this is his chance to go out and show these coaches, hey, this is what I can do in big games when my team needs me. And he is executing to perfection tonight. Very proud of him as a friend, as a fan, and as a friend. He is doing a great job, and this team is playing so well, playing so unified. Love to see that. And that all starts with the head coach, Brian Basil.
Brian Basil, obviously going with that mentality, we will win. And are you thinking we will win tonight? 40-7. 40-7, that's a pretty big gap. I'm thinking we will win tonight.
This team is definitely deserves to win. The way that they have been playing throughout the game, they are playing inspired. They are playing for each other. And that is they are playing as a team, and that is something that Coach Basil has got to be tickled to see. As LD Bell is going to take this kick return some good distance all the way to the 36-yard line, as where that was number 18 for LD Bell on the kick return. Jarvis Jones, he's a defensive back, a senior, and also the kick returner, a defensive back, the kick returner.
Jarvis Jones, is that a famous person? Because that name, that sounds like a professional football player, maybe a, I don't know.
There's James Jones, there's multiple Joneses, and some score updates from around our district. Marcus Marauders are beating the Hebron Hawks 31-24 in the fourth quarter, which is a very big game, because those are two teams that the Jaguars are gonna have to beat if they want to make it to the state playoffs.
And that was a pass from Austin Brookham to not sure what receiver, and it was a pickup of 2 yards. The Jaguar defense was completely ready for that play and didn't even let them go anywhere. And another score update for you: Trinity is beating Byron Nelson 14-7, so not beating them
shock.
As bad as we thought. And that's still the third quarter, as a sack from number 33, Grant Outram. What a play. He came around the corner and found the quarterback, Austin Brookham, who was rolling out in the bootleg, tackled right behind him. And the coaches are on the field, not happy about something. And let's see what they're about to call. And they're going to call a face mask on Grant Outram. I didn't see it personally, but they call what they want. I don't see a flag on the field.
Yeah, it looked like he got his face mask really good there whenever he was tackling, and, you know, just not a very smart play there. You know, it didn't take a lot to bring the quarterback down, and just a really big ill-advised play there by Grant Outram, resulting in a big gain there from LD Bell. Just uncanny.
Yeah. So now on the Jaguar 47-yard line, it's first down and 10 for the Blue Raiders. And that was excuse me, that was number 23, Ivan Traylor, the starting running back for the Raiders. A pickup of 1 yard, just tried to jam it up the middle and didn't go anywhere.
He's a little shaken up after that hit that Connor Lee delivered on him. He popped him right there, and Traylor, limping a little bit coming off the sidelines, was definitely shaken up after that hit. Brookham is going to send his wide receiver in motion. They're going to fake the handoff, give it to the running back. He's going to run up the seam to the 35-yard line and tackled by, that is number, turn a little bit more, 21, Matt Greenwood for the Flymount Jaguars with the tackle. The safety coming up and making the tackle on the running back.
That was number 26, Terry Pace on the carry. He seems like he's been a little bit more dynamic for the Raiders tonight, but they've kept in Ivan Traylor.
Yeah, not a lot of offense, obviously, from the LD Bell Blue Raiders as a flag is thrown by the official there.
That was, again, excuse me, that was Terry Pace again on the carry. It was only a pickup of about 2 yards, but there is a flag, and it's another face mask call on Dylan Carrillo. And that's two in a row. I'm not sure. I didn't see it. It seemed like there was four or five guys who were there to make the tackle.
It looked like it was blocked from us, but the official who had the best angle at it was the one who threw the flag. So I can only assume that, you know, he made the right call on that play and, you know, just trying to make sure that everybody's staying safe because those face masks are very, very – it's a very dangerous play. Brookham is going to be in the shotgun. His man is going to move to the right side. He's going to hand it off to Pace. Pace is going to get hit by Connor Lee and driven into the ground at the 16-yard line. That is going to be a gain of about 3 yards. Now second down and 7. 40 seconds left in this third quarter. Jaguars lead 40-7 over the Hurst LD Bell Blue Raiders. Jaguars playing phenomenally tonight on both the offensive and defensive side of the ball, resulting in this 33-point lead. LD Bell trying to put a dent in that lead, trying to score at least some points here. Have not scored since the first quarter of play on that, gosh, it was about 80-yard touchdown throw by Brookham to number two, Ricky Walton. They're going to hand it to Pace, and that's going to be a huge block in the back there. Two flags coming in. That was number 14, DeCalvis Butler, who just very obviously blocked the cornerback Sterling Deary in the back. Two flags coming in, and that is going to move back LD Bell some yardage. And two flags. It's going to be a holding and a block in the back.
I assume that they're just going to go with the block in the back penalty, the 15 yards, I believe.
I think it's 15, yes, sir.
15. It is a personal foul. And that's a third penalty on this drive. As David Lawrence, number 10, David Lawrence makes his way onto the field for Connor Lee, who's walking off a little gingerly. I just think he's tired. He's played a heck of a game tonight, deserves a rest. And that's one of my good buddies, David Lawrence, coming into the game for the Flymount Jaguars. And it's second down and 15 yards for...
only a 10-yard penalty.
The Raiders, excuse me, 10-yard penalty for the Raiders. There's 2 seconds left in the third quarter, and they're going to go ahead and let it run off.
That will do it for the third quarter of action here at Neil E. Wilson Stadium. Your Flymount Jaguars lead the Hurst LD Bell Blue Raiders 40-7. Back with the final quarter of play here on Flymount Sports Network and Friday Night Glory.
15, ball at the 24-yard line.
Back for the fourth quarter of action here at Neil E. Wilson Stadium on this beautiful October night. Alongside Hayden Bumpus, I'm Shepard Branch. Brookham is going to hand it off to his running back. That is number 23 for LD Bell. Ivan Traylor, the star running back so far for this team throughout the season. Jaguars have had every single answer for Traylor so far. Really anything that the LD Bell Blue Raiders have thrown at this Jaguar defense except for one throw has been stopped with authority.
And for our listeners who are not from the DFW area, the degrees out here, it's 62 degrees out here. A little windy, but 62, that's nice.
That's pretty. As that is going to be a sack there by number 55 for the Jaguars. Chase Sutherland, the defensive lineman, gets to Brookham first, and Brookham has no answer, cannot escape the pressure, and that is going to be a sack of 11 yards. Now fourth down and 21 for LD Bell.
And obviously they're going to go for it down 40-7 with 10 minutes and 50 seconds left in the third quarter. On the Fairmount 32-yard line, they're going to need one of those deep pass miracles to score here. But the the Fairmount secondary will not stand for it, I'm sure, as they've had probably their best game all year.
Score update from Fairmount Jaguars District. Marcus Marauders now lead Hebron 31-30 with 9:50 left in the fourth quarter. Your Jaguars lead 42-7 over Hurst LD Bell. And Southlake is currently beating Louisville. That is 49-7. Southlake Dragons definitely the powerhouse right now. And Louisville put on a whooping last week against Marcus in the Battle of the Axe. That was like 41-14, something along those lines. And they are now on the receiving end of a beatdown right now in Southlake.
If Marcus were to lose, that's actually a big loss if Marcus loses, because Hebron is not supposed to be a great team. They are a good team, obviously. But Marcus came into this thinking, we're one of the best teams in this district, not counting probably Southlake and Euless, obviously the best two teams
in
this district.
Speaking of Euless, Euless is now tied 14-14 with the worst team, 0-5 in the district, Byron Nelson. That is unbelievable. You could ask me so many times if that would have ever happened, and I would have told you 11 times out of 10 that there is no way that Byron Nelson would even be playing the same game as Euless Trinity. But they are tied right now.
And that was Austin Brookham who stepped back and tried to make a big play, but the secondary for the Fairmount Jaguars nearly picking it off and the D-line putting pressure on him. So that's a turnover on downs. And the Jaguars will have the ball at their own 32-yard line with 10 minutes, 27 seconds left in the fourth quarter. The score is 40-7. And Shepard, sorry to interrupt you. You go ahead.
No, absolutely. Just talking about the fact that Euless is now tied. But back to the action here in Fairmount, as Josh Vieira will be the tailback now for the Jaguars, throwing in some new faces. And at wide receiver, number 15 for the Jaguars, Simon Bayou. Bayou?
That's Simon Below.
Below. All right. They're going to hand it off to Vieira. Vieira is going to try and hit the gap, and he will be slung around the body of number 55 for LD Bell. That is Michael Dyson. He's like a Dyson vacuum.
As a man who worked at Bed Bath & Beyond, I know the amazing abilities of the Dyson vacuums. So I believe that
as Kurt,
he's a good
our director,
player.
did not understand that Hayden did work a stint at Bed Bath and Beyond.
Number 31, Matthew Jesko is going to make his way onto the field for Billy Sikora. Also onto the field is number 3, Will Huber.
Huber's been in there a little bit. He's a big proponent of this Jaguar wide receiving core, but haven't been calling his name as much as we used to, with Jake Welch now back in the starting lineup and being very healthy, as Bear is going to take the rush all the way to the 41-yard line. It's going to be a gain of around 9. Now third down and 1. 9:23 left in the game. Jaguars lead the LD Bell Raiders 40-7. Jaguars putting on a clinic so far. Looking to keep that going here at beautiful Neil E. Wilson Stadium in wonderful Flymount, Texas.
Josh Vieira, really a quick kid. He was moving right there. Made his way around the corner and was moving at like 20 miles an hour.
And he is going to hit a gap. He is going to get taken down at the 46-yard line. But first he will pick up the first down. He will move the chains for the Jaguars. Jaguars still have 3 timeouts. Not really worried about having them or having to use them with this very large lead. But, you know, Coach Basil obviously has got to think that his team has put the nail in the coffin so far in this game. And, you know, he's got the next team on his mind, which is Hebron.
Hebron, weren't expecting much from them, but playing Marcus very close, as we said. Marcus is a great football team with a phenomenal defense, is really what they're known for, led by the Iowa commit, Matt Hankins.
Vieira's going to take the ball. He's going to stutter step and only going to get a gain of 1 yard. These Jaguars are going to most likely improve to 2-1 in district play. Got to think that it's going to take 4 wins to get out. Looking down the schedule, you've got Hebron next week, the Mound Showdown the week after that. Then you've got Euless Trinity and Louisville to round out the schedule. And got to win 2 of 4. And you circle the Marcus game and you circle the Hebron game as the ones that you think are going to be the easiest to get that victory with. Euless being the phenomenal team that they are. They play so poised. They're so disciplined. Have that winning tradition instilled in their team. And then you have Louisville, who has a pair of stout wide receivers that can wreak havoc on any secondary that they face.
Tyrell Schaefer's the Alabama commit.
Goodness.
From Louisville wide receiver.
Not very many kids around this area that are going to play for Alabama.
He stands at a whopping 6'7". That's right, you heard that right. 6'7". And he
runs,
like
a 4.34.
And he is super fast, can jump crazy high. I mean, the dude's an animal, and Alabama is getting a good one next year, and they are excited.
Schaefer obviously not having the impact that you thought he would on an OU commit, Robert Barnes, who plays for Southlake. He definitely played very well against the Jaguars, and nothing got past him throughout the game. Jaguars only scoring 7 points against Southlake, but as it will be a flag on the Jaguars there for that play. It was a handoff to Josh Vieira. He got a gain of about 6 yards, and it will be erased, moved back 10 yards with a personal foul call on the Jaguars. Back to the 50-yard line. Excuse me.
First and 20 from the 50-yard line. Jaguars moving the ball pretty well, although having really mostly their second team in. And really right now, they're just going to keep running the ball, trying to work the clock, screen passes, draws, but they're never, I don't think, going to take any chances. As this game is pretty much done, 6 minutes, 20 seconds on the clock left in the game. 40-7 the score, and the Jaguars have just put on a clinic on defense and offense, led by Jackson Averett.
It's been a long time coming for these Jaguars, as Jackson Averett is just going to throw this all the way over to his wide receiver on the sidelines, trying to keep from getting sacked. But the Jaguars, the winning tradition is slowly making its way back into Flower Mound territory here. Jaguars only won about 3 games in the last 3 seasons, and only won 1 game last year, and within the first game of this season, tied their win total from last year. So got off on the right foot. Like we said, those 3 losses in a row definitely put a bump in the road for these Jaguars, but they are going to get back-to-back district wins, which are really the only wins that matter from this point on, and a 2-1 team in district and a 3-3 total is very, very great for Coach Brian Basil and this coaching staff, Coach Basil in his first year as the Jaguar head coach, as it was a penalty there on the Jaguars, going to move him back in another 10 yards. Luckily, they can afford it.
Yeah, a very long third down and 35 yards.
Oh, that's nothing. It's just a pitch and a catch.
I got a feeling we're going to get the first down here. No, I don't think they're going to even really take a shot. I'm just expecting a handoff and...
Take your medicine.
Take your medicine and punt it away. And Hebron has taken the lead against Marcus, if you're interested in that game. It's 33-31, 4 minutes to play in the game. And that's a shocker if Hebron were to pull that out. And that's exciting.
Actually, I'd say that that's one of the most even matchups so far in this district is, you know, Marcus has won a couple district games. They beat LD Bell, and then they also beat Byron Nelson. But then they got stomped by... Louisville, so Hebron, I think, is the same way. It's kind of those middle-of-the-pack teams, and I think that the Flyermount Jaguars have thrown their name into the mix with those middle-of-the-pack. Those are going to be the three teams that are going to be fighting, vying for the last two spots here and in district to make the playoffs.
We apologize about earlier. That was second down and 35, not third down and 35, and they're going to go and run it on the third down and 30, and that's a pickup of... Two yards, probably.
About four yards. Now inside 5 minutes here in this game, as it looks like the Jaguars are just going to send out their punting unit. Going to boot this one away, and...
That's Clayton Stewart on a punt, the, I believe, junior. Go ahead and giving... Josh Grant a rest after a phenomenal day with the fake punts and the two great field goals, and was pretty much perfect from PATs, except for the blocked one, obviously. Clayton Stewart going to go ahead and punt this one away, and oh,
holy
wow.
Cow, that was booted. That was very, very deep into, looks like the wind's calmed down a little bit, but still into a pretty good wind, and he punted that. Carried it about 50 yards. That was mashed.
That was deep, and that didn't even count roll. They caught that in the air. That could have been all the way into the end zone with a good bounce. Clayton Stewart, the young junior kicker, has learned a lot from Josh Grant. I've heard plenty of stories. Josh, one of my good buddies, was talking about sort of a mentor to him, has been sort of a mentor to him, teaching him really the basics of kicking. And
what better person to have, somebody that is experienced, somebody that has exposure and that knows the recruiting process very well and what it takes to kick at a high level. You know, those are the kids that you want to be able to pick their brains. Handoff for LD Bell to the outside, and it's going to be a flag thrown, might very possibly going to be a hold on the offense. That's what's going to be. It's going to move LD Bell back an extra 5 yards. Check that. I think it's going to be a personal foul call. It will be half the distance to the goal. First down and 16 as the clock runs just under 4 minutes. Jaguars lead 42-7. Pass by LD Bell to wide receiver. That is number 11 for LD Bell. Edgar Rodriguez, the senior wide receiver who makes the catch for a gain of 11 yards.
And these Flyermount fans have been sticking it out, haven't left yet, and this is a passionate student section.
It's been a long night.
Talking a lot tonight. A passionate student section, as there's a flag down on this play. It was a run play to Ivan Traylor, and he picked up about 1 yard, and the flag will be unsportsmanlike conduct on the Raiders, and that's going to move him back 15 yards again. A personal foul last play, and now a unsportsmanlike. This is just a team that's frustrated, I think. They haven't really played probably to their best of ability. But these Jags have played really the best game from start to finish. They've played a full game where they've played solid throughout.
And this is a talented team, too. You can see that this LD Bell team has a lot of raw talent and a lot of athletes. That's the one thing that the WT White team really didn't show was, you know, that they really had a good team. But this is, you know, a 6A football team in the state of Texas. You know, LD Bell is no joke, and the Jaguars just came in and played ridiculously well, and defense played stout other than one play, and that's why the Jaguars are right now have this very, very large lead and most likely going to win this game and move to 2-1 in district play.
Austin Brookham's going to go and pull that one from the running back and take it himself, and that's going to be a pickup of 1 yard. Tackled by number 17, Davis Frondorf, and it's going to be fourth down and 15 yards, and the Blue Raiders are going to go ahead and punt it away, and that is number 28, Sterling Deary, back to return the punt, and here's the punt again, the low punt with the big spin, and this one's going to take a generous bounce. And it's going to be downed at the 41-yard line. And that's great starting field position for the Jaguars.
Jaguars, 2:15 of clock, 2 minutes and 15 seconds of clock to run down here before they seal this victory. I guess let's talk about the key players of this game. Brandon Baku has played so well, and, you know, it's so hard whenever you play really well 1 week to transfer it over. There's the, you know, obviously teams take notice of that. They circle your number whenever they see the roster and say, hey, this kid's really talented. But he has done so well with getting that attention from the offensive line from LD Bell, but still being able to make plays happen. And then on the offensive side of the ball, as Landon Sadler, the snap goes through his hands and he's going to have to just jump on it. Jackson Averett, the quarterback, he is the, you know, linchpin for this offense. Everything goes through him, from the handoffs, from, you know, his QB reads that he does to the passes. He's the one who is the facilitator of this offense, and every single game we see him getting better and better, getting more comfortable, communicating better with his players, and, you know, I'm so excited to see what he's going to do every single week, because it just gets... You know, he gets better, and the competition gets tougher, and the games get bigger and harder to win, and he lives up to the hype.
Also to mention, the captain of this team, Connor Lee, as Landon Sadler is going to go and take this snap and hand it off to Josh Vieira, and he's going to hit the hole, and that's a solid pickup of 5 yards.
That'll make it from third and 33.
Yeah. That'll make it third down and 23. But yeah, like I was saying, Connor Lee, obviously – just the star player of this team, and you see him every day, every game. You're going to say his number a lot. You're going to say his name a lot. And we've said a lot tonight. We mentioned Baku, obviously, the phenomenal game he's had, but Connor Lee's going to have a phenomenal game every week, and again, a phenomenal game this week. Landon Sadler's going to go and take the snap and go to Vieira again. Oh, excuse me, he's going to keep it. He faked me out big time there, and he faked out the...
The rest of the team also. Except for the LD Bell defense, they did a really good job of swarming there to the quarterback, and that is going to be a gain of about 10 yards there, 5 yards, about 5 yards. And we'll see as about 20 seconds left on the game clock. And they will have to take a delay of game, and then that will do it for the Jaguars. We would like to thank everybody who has been a part of this broadcast. Kurt Watson, our director, everybody on the field, everybody behind the cameras. We could not do it without them, as the Jaguars are going to take a delay of game with 2 seconds left. As the players start shaking hands and the coaches take off their headsets, the Jaguars will move to 3-3 on the season, but most importantly, 2-1 in district play. As
I think LD Bell declined the penalty, that way they didn't have to bring their offense out onto the field. They're just going to snap the ball to Landon Sadler, and I'm sure he's going to run around and just let the clock run out. And there's a snap, and
he's going to take the knee.
And
that is going to do it for us here at Neil E. Wilson Stadium. Your Flower Mound Jaguars win it 40-7 over the Hearst LD Bell Raiders. We will be at Hebron next week with more district coverage. Alongside Hayden Bumpus, I'm Sherbert Branch. This has been Flower Mound Sports Network and Friday Night Glory's coverage of your Flower Mound Jaguars. Have a great night, and we'll see you next week.